Inside the Museum of Texas Tech University, you'll find something called the NSRL, or the Natural Science Research Laboratory. It's filled with millions of specimens collected over many decades, and all are available for scientists to analyze. Robert Bradley is the NSRL's director.
They're used by faculty members at Texas Tech, all over the United States, and in some cases all over the world. People write us or call us and ask for loans. Maybe it's a tissue loan for some project they're doing. Maybe it's a handful of specimens that they want to look at.
You can divide the NSRL into five collections: mammals, invertebrates, birds, genetic resource collection, and radioactive collection. In the mammals collection, you'll find bats, rodents, and much more. While similar collections may house around 10,000 specimens, the NSRL has about 125,000.
It's a fantastic resource in terms of being able to come over and work with specimens that have been collected over a decade. To do a proper study of that in the absence of something like the NSRL, we'd actually have to go out to the field and catch all of those different bats and look at all those things. But for us now, we have these bats in the collection here already, so we can just come over to the museum and open a drawer and there they are.
Researchers studying insects and arachnids have an even bigger bank to tap into.
The invertebrate zoology collection is huge by most standards. It's about 4.5 million specimens.
By comparison, the bird collection is fairly small, between 6,000 and 8,000 specimens. And in the genetic resource collection, you'll find more than 300,000 tissue samples taken from about 90,000 individuals. They're stored in liquid nitrogen freezers, protecting the samples for researchers like Caleb Phillips for many years to come.
And so I'm drawing heavily on the colon and fecal samples to study the digestive microbiota of these organisms. So the basic purpose of my research is to understand how microbial organisms that live in and on us, in wild populations, how they help function.
Most of the specimens in the radioactive collection were taken from Chernobyl, the site of one of the world's worst nuclear power plant disasters.
So what they did is they went in and they collected rodents all over the Chernobyl area. Then they collected rodents outside the area that hadn't been impacted by the radiation plume that moved through the environment. And so they looked at mutation rates. I think it's pretty unique because no one else saved any material. And so if you want to go start, you know, researching on Chernobyl today, we have material we could loan you, and off you go. Most of the other scientists didn't archive anything.
The collections housed within the NSRL continue to grow, thanks to researchers who rely on them.
If you take samples out of that collection, it makes perfect sense that you would go in and put samples back in. So we do go out to New Mexico and northern Texas and other places around. We've contributed probably 500 specimens in the past couple of years.
And it's not only a research and recruiting tool.
One of the reasons I took this job was because of the NSRL.
The NSRL is a teaching tool too.
Anything from when I'm bringing new students into the lab, I can have them come over to the museum and they can actually look at some of the specimens to get a sense for what their study animal is before they go out in the field. Anytime that we have a project where we're going out and collecting tissue samples, previously we would have collected those tissue samples and then they would have lived in a freezer in my lab after we were finished with them, when we would be the only ones that knew they were there. Now with the NSRL, we can deposit those tissues in the collection and we can make maximum use of those tissues or even just archive them for decades to come until we have new ideas and new technologies for what we can do with those tissues.
It's a huge collection. It's a really valuable collection and it's really an invaluable resource.